Good morning everyone, my name is Arvasist and I welcome all of you in this class of Johar Edu Campus. And today we are going to start a very important session on prelim exams that you may confront after some time. So this stage of prelim is very very crucial. It is very very important because once you clear this prelim exams, you get the chance to appear for mains and then interview. So your gateway of success start right from here. You may become the deputy collector and you may also occupy some other important and responsible positions just after 1 year of time. But first of all, you will have to clear this important hurdle, right? But once you clear this important hurdle, your competition is going to be significantly reduced. It will be reduced to the extent of almost 10 to 20 times. Why I am saying that? This is simply because the number of candidates in the prelim is very high as compared to the number of candidates in your mains. So once you clear your prelims, obviously the number of candidates with whom you may have the competitions will get significantly reduced and you may get advantage over some other candidates provided your mains preparation has been up to the mark. But I have seen many candidates in my teaching of students for the last 8 years of time that they have been able to clear the prelims, but mains preparation is not up to mark. So this also is not going to help them out. If you want to finally crack these exams and occupy the position that you are aspiring for, you'll have to ensure that you devote the equal time to both the examinations. The importance of obviously mains is very very high, but you cannot play down the importance of prelims in this examinations. As I told you that this is the gateway of success, this is the first hurdle that you have to cross if you want to be in the second round of competitions. So today in this session we will comment some fundamental rules about clearing the prelims by looking at the nature of examinations and the pattern of questions that is being asked by the JPSC. We'll formulate some fundamental rules that can help you to clear this examinations with a very little amount of efforts, right? My name is Arvasist and I think that the first segment of prelims will be started with my topic. This is Indian economy, right? You know that there are 100 questions being asked in the prelim stage. Each carry 2 marks. So you have prelims of 200 marks of GS paper 1, and out of 100 questions, Indian economy account for 10 questions. Every year 10 questions is being asked by the by the JPSC, right? That means the weightage of Indian economy is 20 out of 200 marks, 10%. And I have seen that since the weightage of Indian economy has been lower as compared to other segment of GS like history or polity, you people tend to ignore the importance. You people tend to ignore the subject altogether. And it is not only the students that are ignoring the importance of Indian economy in prelims, even the coaching institutes and the teachers, they play down the importance of Indian economy. They disparage the importance of Indian economy in their prelim preparation. But this is not going to be a wise decision. This is not going to be helping for you. Because even though it carries 20 marks of weightage, even though the number of questions is only 10, but you can secure all these marks with minimum amount of efforts, with minimum amount of time devoted. Like if you are going to cover other comprehensive areas, for example, history. I'm not going to, you know, play down the importance of history as well. But if you go to cover the subject of history, it will require lots of time. It will require lots of efforts as well. But so far as economics is concerned, syllabus has been very precise. Syllabus has been very limited. Topics that you need to complete is very, very limited. You can secure all the marks in Indian economy just by providing a minimum amount of time and putting in little amount of efforts or drudgery. So there lies the wisdom of not ignoring Indian economy in your preparation for prelims. You just need to give appropriate amount of time. You just need to put appropriate amount of efforts, and you'll find that you have been able to secure, let's suppose the weightage is 20 marks, let's suppose you have been able to secure 15 marks. So these 15 marks is going to help you come ahead of other candidates, right? So this is the time you need to identify which areas you need to focus so that you may come ahead of other candidates. Like other candidates are completing their polity, they are completing their history, they are completing their current affairs, and you are also doing the same, you know, kind of things. So obviously you cannot expect that you will get ahead of all those candidates, because areas are not different, efforts are not different, time devoted are not different, they are equally identical, right? So now you have to identify some more areas so that you can just leave those people behind. So if you have been able to secure 15 marks out of, let's suppose, 20 marks by putting in very small amount of time, by putting in very small amount of efforts, then obviously you'll have an edge over other candidates. This is what I'm going to emphasize here. This is what I have come for. I have come for to convince you that this is the area you must not leave out. This is the area you must focus, you must provide appropriate amount of time and effort so that you just come out flying colors in this examination. But I'm not going to put the entire burden on you people. I'm not going to say that you just go through the books, go through the syllabus and put an colossal amount of time and efforts. That's not going to yield the result. What I'm trying to do is to just, be companion of yours. I will provide all the inputs, I will provide all the materials and the areas that you must focus so that you do not have difficulty in economics. I'm going to complete this session on Indian economy in around 10 to 12 classes. And 10 to 12 classes are more than sufficient for you to fetch at least 15 marks out of 20 marks. So there is no harm. There is no harm at all breaking the pattern of preparation that you have been going through for a long time. You people have been ignoring this subject for a long time. But now break this pattern of preparation and start giving importance to Indian economy as well. Once you start giving importance to Indian economy, I told you that you will have advantage over other candidates, because most of the candidates tend to ignore this portion of general study. But when you start completing even the topics of Indian economy, obviously you will have advantage over other candidates. But we have to think over the fact why students and coaching centers tend to, you know, ignore this subject. The first reason is that they consider this subject to be the complicated one. They consider that economics are, you know, technical, data are complicated, and due to these complications, they just ignore these subjects and emphasize on some other subjects so that they are not that uncomfortable in the preparation of prelims. But yes, I also agree that there are some complications, but it is not the pure economics that you need to study. You need to distinguish between Indian economy and pure economics. When we talk of pure economics, look here. When we talk of pure economics, you may have different areas of economics. Like you may have microeconomics, you have macroeconomics, then international economics, public finance, then welfare economics, growth and development. These are the areas, different branches of economics. Economics as a science needs to be covered in all these areas. You have to complete micro, macro, international economics, public finance, welfare economics, growth and development, and some others. You don't need to read all these things because the syllabus and the topics that have been provided as the syllabus of JPSC contains the areas from Indian economy only. Indian economy. You don't need to care about what are the theories of microeconomics, what are the theories of macroeconomics, how international trade and investment functions in the economy. That is the subject matter of international economics. You don't need to care about the public finance. Yes, to some extent you need to have the idea about the public finance or the finance of the government, and that basically you come to know through the economic survey or the budget, right? Then you don't have to think of the different complicated theories on growth and development or the welfare economics. These are not the areas that you need to complete. You just need to concentrate upon Indian economy. You just need to have the ideas about Indian economy. What are the important features of Indian economy? Then you must have the idea of the structure of our economy, right? Then you must have the idea about how the Indian economy has been doing over the last 70 years as compared to other countries, what have been the various reforms that we have been undertaking to make progress on social and economic fronts. So these are the things that you must know about the Indian economy, right? The basic important features of Indian economy, the structure of Indian economy, what kind of economy we are, how the agriculture system is working in our country, what is the conditions of industry in our country, what is the service sector and the importance of service sector in the productions of output, employment, right? And then you have to know about the reforms that we have been undertaking for the last 70 years, time to time, and the biggest reforms in recent times was undertaken by Government of India in 1991. So since we have been living in this country, since we have been the part of the process of development that has been taking place in our country, Indian economy is not something very strange to us. It is not something alien to us. We know every aspect of the economy. And for that, you don't need to be that disturbed that it's a technical subject and you won't be able to complete it without putting in much and more time without putting in much and more efforts. No, because it basically relates to our economy in which we have been living. It relates to the economy we are the part of, which, right? So you just need to put a very small amount of time and efforts, and you will see that you can solve at least 75% of questions out of the weightage that has been assigned for Indian economy. So within 20 hours of time, I'm going to complete all the important syllabus, all the important topics that pertains to Indian economy. You may have seen the syllabus of Indian economy, right? And you just need to study some fundamental books, very fundamental books. And that's also required for the preparation of mains, right? Because once you prepare yourself for mains, I think that 70 to 80% of your syllabus of prelim will automatically covered. You don't need to make a separate study of prelims. Once you start, you know, preparing for mains, you will find that 70 to 80% by the time you complete all the topics of, you know, mains, you will find that 70 to 80% of your syllabus has been completed, right? But yes, when the PT comes, or before, I think that 3 to 4 months of time must be exclusively devoted for the preparation of prelims. First, you just complete all the topics of mains. You'll find that, you know, many of the topics that you have been completing in the preparation of mains will help you even in prelims, right? So the 70 to 80% of prelims will get covered in the process of your completing the syllabus of mains, right? And remaining 30%, you'll have to make an extra effort, and those efforts needs to be, you know, done by you when the examination is 3 to 4 months away, right? And these 3 to 4 months should be crucial and must be exclusively devoted for the preparation of prelims. So what fundamental books that you need to study? You know, for the sake of, you know, understanding the structure of our Indian economy and its development, there is an NCERT book available in the market, and this NCERT book is class 11th NCERT book. Class 11th NCERT book, and this book is called Development of Indian Economy. So you need to go through this book again and again, at least twice or thrice, or till the time the entire concept of these books have been imprinted in your mind. You have to go through this book. And this is not because it is meant for the prelims. I'm not saying that it's meant for prelims only. This book will help you understand the structure of Indian economy and how the economy of India developed since 1947. So the book will help you not only in your prelims but also in your mains. And I think that this is the most fundamental book. This is the most basic book that is available in the market for Indian economy, for understanding of Indian economy. Before referring to any of the market material available, you have to go through this book. You have to complete all the chapters of this class 11th NCERT book. That will make you understand the features of Indian economy, the structure of Indian economy, and its development since 1947. So this is the book that you have to go through time and again in order to make your idea very clear about the structure of our Indian economy and some other dimensions of our Indian economy. This book has been presented in a very logical manner. Like, you have some topics given as syllabus. Like the first topic that you have to complete, The first topic that you have to complete is important features of Indian economy. Important features of Indian economy. Indian economy. So this is the syllabus for prelims. You have to know about the features of Indian economy. And to know about the features of Indian economy, you have to look into some past incidents in our country. You cannot understand the features of Indian economy till you study about the British rule in our country and how the British rule in our country transformed the fundamental structure of our economy, right? And the best thing that you have to start from is the class 11th NCERT book of Indian Economic Development, right? And then you have the syllabus like sustainable development and other issues of Indian economy. This is the environmental economics that you have to focus. This is the economics about the environment, how the activities or various economic activities, you know, impact our environment, it impacts our resources, and how we are going to strike a good balance between the present use and the future use of resources so that coming generations do not have any difficulties, you know, continuing with their life as we are living today, right? Then you have to cover the economic reforms. You have to cover the economic reforms. And one more topic is globalization, right? So when we talk of economic reforms, you know that it is not a one-time process. Rather, economic reforms is a continuous process. It has been undertaken by the government even today, as it was being undertaken by the government in the previous years. So the process will continue. Even the new government will come later on. The new government will have to also undertake some of the economic reforms, because as the nature and situation of the economy is soon changing, we have to replace some old policies, we have to replace some, you know, previous policies and adopt some new policies, right? So we have to undertake various reforms as the economy progresses. So obviously in this particular topic, you don't need to read about the reforms that were undertaken by the government in the previous years, right? In the previous years, in the sense that before 1980 at least. The new phase of economic reforms began to surface after 1980, right? And that culminated into complete reforms in 1991. So reforms of 1991 that took our economy on the path of liberalization, privatization and globalization. So that is the very important reforms you have to study about. What we mean by liberalization, what we mean by privatization and globalization of the economy, what have been their impact, right? But you don't have to stop your preparation there only, right? Some more reforms have been adopted by the government even after 1991. Like, you know that we just brought about a big reforms in taxation area in 2017. The GST has been introduced. It was introduced on 1st July 2017. So this has been the biggest reforms in taxation arena. And obviously when you study about economic reforms in this particular topic, you simply cannot live out the reforms of, you know, GST that we have adopted in 2017. Some more reforms may have been adopted by the government after 1991, right? All these reforms, like the reforms in bank arena, the reforms in fiscal policy, the reforms on external front, right? All these reforms need to be studied even after 1991. But yes, of course, you don't need to read about the reforms that was undertaken by the government in 1951 or 1970, right? You don't need to do that. But yes, you have to commence your topics on economic reforms from the period of 1991, but you have to continue with all the reforms that was undertaken by the government in subsequent years, right? Then globalization is one of the component of economic reforms that will get covered once you complete the LPG or the liberalization, privatization or globalization, right? All these topics can have the fundamental in terms of class 11th NCERT book, right? Class 11th NCERT book on Indian economic development, will give you the idea about important features of Indian economy and why those features keep on continue with our economy. What have been the historical background of those features? You'll get the idea once you start reading the NCERT of class 11th, right? Then in some chapters you'll have the conflict between the economy and environment. Like if we emphasize on augmenting the supply of goods and services, we have to set up industries, right? We have to set up industries in a rapid manner, in a comprehensive manner. But if we go for the expansion of industries, that is going to pollute our environment, that is going to result into lower of forest areas, right? And ultimately that will have the implications for our health, and even coming generations will get deprived of many of the benefits that natural resources endow on us, right? So in some chapters you will get the idea that there is a conflict, there is a trade-off between what we call the economic activity and secondly what we call the environment, right? Now we have to strike a balance, right? And this has not been the important aspect of our economy only. The worldwide we find that, you know, countries are jostling, they are, you know, making struggle to strike a balance between the environment and the economic activity so that livelihood of people can be maintained, right? And then economic reforms is one of the chapters that you'll find in class 11th NCERT book. So basically what happens, why the result has been much lower from the coaching institutes? The reason is that students focus on material that is available in the market without completing the basic or fundamental books in terms of NCERT. I'm not saying that coaching material is irrelevant. I'm not saying that all the materials that is available in the market is not going to help you. They will help you definitely. There is no doubt about that. Because if something is going to be printed for you by the teachers, obviously that is going to help you, no doubt. But you have to know where to start from. If you go after study materials provided by the coaching institutes without reading the NCERT, then obviously it's not going to help you. Make sure that you first complete your NCERT. And once you have completed your NCERT, you'll find that the study material that has been provided to you and that may remain available in the market from where you purchase, obviously that becomes your, you know, just the easiest thing ever in your preparation, right? So there has to be a sequence that you need to follow. There has to be a, you know, step by step process that you need to know in order to, you know, get a mastery over any particular subject. So I want you to be the, you know, not the master of economics, but at least, I mean, you need to be that comfortable that you easily handle the questions from economics, right? And as I told you that if you have been able to score 15 marks out of, you know, 20 marks, then obviously it's going to give you an advantage over other candidates, right? So let's suppose everybody has the same areas of focus, but you have been putting an extra effort in completing even the topics of economics that other candidates have been ignoring, then obviously that is going to give you advantage, right? But when you start from the market material without going through the fundamental books or fundamental topic, that will make your task the difficult one. You'll get confused, and after some time you will simply just leave the preparation of economics. You will say that yes, it's a complicated, and just like other candidates, you simply leave it out. That's not going to help you. Make sure that the study material that you pick up is going to, is helpful for you. And for that, you need to first complete the NCERT or the fundamental book. Why I'm suggesting this fundamental books of class 11th NCERT, as I told you that this has been a very handy book for Indian economy, to know about the structure of Indian economy, and this will help you not only in your prelims but also in mains examination. So I give you the brief outline of this book, right? I'm going to give you the brief idea of this book and how this book is going to help you in completing all these topics. No doubt I'm going to complete all these topics one by one within 20 hours of my classes. But of course, simultaneously, if you go through the NCERT, you find that my class has been very, very, understanding. It has been very, very helpful. And when you just try to solve the questions from the previous years, obviously, this will help you a lot and you become comfortable, right? So far as this book is concerned, the name of this book is Development of Indian Economy or Indian Economic Development. So basically, you study about the development of Indian economy in this particular book. But when we talk of development of Indian economy, the first question is where it has to be started from, right? Where the development has to be started from, where the development has to be, read from. Do we need to study about the development of Indian economy from Mughal time or even back to that period from the Maurya period or Gupta ones? No, you don't need to go that back. Even you don't need to study about the Indian economy from the Mughal time, right? But yes, you need to study about the development of Indian economy when India became a free country. India became a free country in 1947. And before that, there has been the rule of the British government for almost 200 years in our country. British government ruled India for almost 200 years. And then we became a free country in 1997. So in this particular book, the development of Indian economy has been discussed right from the eve of independence. The first chapter. So the first chapter of this book is chapter 1. So the first chapter is the development of Indian economy on the eve of independence. This is the first chapter. Indian economy on the eve of independence. This is the first chapter. And when you study this chapter, the very first chapter of this book, you come to know about the conditions of our economy when British left India in 1947. You exactly come to know about the conditions of Indian economy at the time of 1947. And to explain the condition of Indian economy in this chapter, some parameters has been used, and even you have to use those parameters when you explain the condition of any economy, including Indian economy, right? So what are the parameters that you have to